Well, I think if the United States stands for anything, we ought to stand out loud and foursquare for human rights. People all over the world count on us to be the voice for human rights. And when we are indifferent, I think it disappoints so many people who are struggling, you know, in some of the most worst conditions that you can possibly imagine. But look, with regard to ISIL, I mean, part of the reason why they're growing is because they tend to show up in countries where there are areas that are ungoverned, where there were vacuums, whether it's in Iraq or in Syria. And so our approach needs to be more imaginative than just bombing the hell out of them, because we've been doing that forever and it doesn't do any good. We need to help, in Syria, we need to help facilitate a negotiated settlement to end all the bombing and to end all the killing and to help, you know, allow that country to be, once again, you know, be governed. And the same thing in Iraq, bringing together the various ethnic groups and religious groups, because there are too many sectarian divides in Iraq. And where there are divides, that's where ISIS comes in. So I think we need a different approach to dealing with ISIS other than just sending more advisors and dropping more bombs. And with Boko Haram, I think we could provide technical assistance to some of the African nations to actually do a better job of going after them. It's not just Boko Haram, it's Joseph Kony and the Lord's Resistance Army that are doing some horrible, horrible things. And we've made some contributions that have helped make a difference, but I think we can play a more productive role in that. Both the United States and China have strong economic ties, and we ought to continue those economic ties. But that doesn't mean we should be silent when they arrest lawyers for defending human rights activists, or be silent while they try to erase the entire Tibetan culture. I mean, I was in China, and I know I was in Beijing. But it was also in Tibet. We were the first congressional group that's been allowed in Tibet in over a decade. Seeing how the Chinese government is cracking down on Tibetan activists, on Tibetan monks, trying to make it more difficult for people to practice their religion, even practice and learn their language, is really disconcerting. And we ought not to be, indifferent, because if you're indifferent, you're complicit. We made it very clear to the Chinese authorities that the human rights is a concern. I asked the highest authorities in China to allow the Dalai Lama to go back to Tibet to be with his people, to respect the rights of the Tibetan people. And they didn't like to hear the message, but we need to repeat it over and over and over and over again so it sinks in. But I think there are some in our government who think that being silent is the price you have to pay for economic relations. I think that's crazy. I mean, the deal is China needs us. Like we need China economically. So we shouldn't be a cheap date when it comes to human rights. Well, first of all, I think people ought to be able to believe what they want to believe. I don't think any government should be able to dictate to you that this has to be your religion and you can't believe this or you can't believe that, number one. But one of the points I made to the Chinese government, who are paranoid over allowing any autonomy to the Tibetan people because they're afraid that somehow it'll lead to more people wanting autonomy. My view is that the current policy of the Chinese government of repressing the Tibetan people, adds to China's insecurity. It doesn't add to its security, it adds to its insecurity. Because more and more people are not only disaffected, and feeling the heat from the Chinese authorities, but many of them are fleeing Tibet and they're angry. That's where the unrest can come from. When the Dalai Lama dies, the Dalai Lama is a voice for peace and nonviolence. But when the Dalai Lama dies, I don't know who will come after him, if anybody, whether there'll even be another Dalai Lama, whether or not he'll be able to, or she will be able to, continue along this lines of, of nonviolence and trying to work out a solution. I mean, so the more the Chinese government represses, whether it's the Tibetans or the Uyghurs or whatever, the more insecurity, I think, for China, the more unrest there is, the more chance for there to be violence and civil unrest. And it's amazing to me that China, this massive country, is so frightened and paranoid over this monk, over this gentle, nonviolent man who is preaching nothing but, goodness. But I think the Dalai Lama is an important kind of bridge to kind of ensuring that they move toward a more autonomous Tibet. Again, the Dalai Lama accepts the Chinese, says that Tibet is in China, so he's not, no one's talking about a separate country, but more autonomy over their culture and over their religion and over their traditions. I don't think that's unreasonable, but I'm hopeful. And I'm meeting with the Chinese ambassador this week, next week, as a follow-up to our trip, and I will reiterate my hope that they'll be more responsive to some of our requests. I'm urging our own government to actually raise the issue of Tibet in a more forceful way, because we have been, whether it's the Bush administration or the Obama administration, we kind of get the same response all the time. You know, we respect His Holiness the Dalai Lama, we believe in autonomy for Tibet, and that's it. But this needs to be raised at the highest levels. This needs to be a priority, and we need to push harder. And now's the time to do it while the Dalai Lama, is still with us and still vibrant and still wanting to be part of the solution. The trip to Tibet was incredible. I mean, I've always dreamed of going to Tibet sometime. I know the Dalai Lama, I admire what he stands for, and I've got to know many of the people who comprise the Tibetan community here in Western Massachusetts. But to go there was really quite incredible. I mean, it's a beautiful place. It's kind of isolated. It's high up. The altitude is unbelievably high. The air is thin. But the Chinese government tried to control our trip. But we forced ourselves to get away from the Chinese government to see what we want to see. We went to monasteries that they didn't want us to go to. We had candid conversations with Tibetan monks that they were not okay with, but we did nonetheless. And we were able to not only hear firsthand about some of the difficulties that the Tibetan communities face, but they also got to hear us reaffirm our support for their cause and our support for His Holiness the Dalai Lama. And everywhere we went, we reiterated that, whether it was in Hong Kong or Beijing, we talked about the Tibetan people and the importance of respecting their culture and allowing the Dalai Lama to go back home.